Hello, space fans. Welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, Japan's black hole telescope is tumbling out of control, amateur astronomers capture a possible impact on Jupiter, and ALMA images the finest detail ever seen in a planet-forming disk around the nearby sun-like star. On February 17th, the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency, or JAXA, launched what it called its premier space telescope dedicated to X-ray astronomy from the Tanegashima Space Center in Kagoshima, Japan. The observatory carries a state-of-the-art instrument and two telescope mirrors built at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center. The satellite was initially called Astro-H and was expected to provide breakthroughs in a wide variety of high-energy phenomena in the cosmos, ranging from superheated material on the brink of falling into the black hole to the evolution of vast galaxy clusters. After launch, JAXA renamed the mission Hitomi, which refers to the pupil, or more specifically, the aperture of the eye. As part of the regular mission schedule, the spacecraft was due to wake up and start responding to ground communications this weekend. At least that's what it was supposed to start doing. Well, last weekend, Saturday, March 26th, JAXA announced that they'd lost contact with the spacecraft in something they termed a communication anomaly, which basically meant that they had lost contact with it but had no idea why and could not ascertain the health of the space telescope. However, later, the Joint Space Operations Center, which tracks all debris floating around in Earth orbit, announced that they'd seen pieces of the satellite breaking up into space last Saturday. This video, taken on March 28th by astronomer Paul Maley in Arizona, shows the satellite getting brighter and darker as it traverses the sky, which suggests that the spacecraft itself is tumbling through space. Then on Tuesday, something happened that allowed JAXA to get two very terse messages from Hitomi in response to their trying to regain contact. These messages were so short, though, that they really couldn't get much info other than the spacecraft is still on, but they couldn't establish a solid connection, much less regain control. So they still don't know what caused it to go offline in the first place, but they are furiously working to reestablish contact. All that spinning is what's preventing any kind of communications lock, but the fact that they got some messages from the spacecraft gives hope that maybe they can recover the spacecraft and figure out what happened. The Department of Defense's Joint Space Operations Center, who originally spotted the satellite shedding debris, said they hadn't seen any evidence that a collision was at fault. That suggests that whatever happened may have occurred on the satellite itself, and its fast spin supports that even further. They say that to get a satellite spinning so fast, it must have been shooting out some kind of gas. Either one of its actual rocket thrusters got stuck on, or possibly the super cold liquid helium boiled off and acted as if it was a rocket thruster. But the cooling system's been working fine for a few weeks, and apparently some of the data that it's returned is actually scientifically exciting. So maybe the stuck thruster is the most likely guess. But at this point, it's just a guess. So here's hoping that they can get the spacecraft under control, because Hitomi represents a big step forward in X-ray astronomy, particularly in X-ray spectroscopy, which gives vital information about high-energy cosmic sources. So far, JAXA remains hopeful that they will regain contact and control over Hitomi and continue on its mission of studying black holes, active galaxies, and a whole host of other high-energy sources in the universe. And of course, I'll keep you posted. Next, many of you have been tweeting and sending me YouTube comments to ask about a possible Jupiter impact that may have occurred on March 17th. It was rumored that amateur astronomers looking at Jupiter that night saw a brief flash of light on the limb of Jupiter. Astronomers are still trying to pin down the specifics, but luckily two amateur videos came out this week showing a bright flash on the edge of Jupiter's disk near the boundary of the planet's bright equatorial zone and its north equatorial belt. For those of you who need them, the system 2 coordinates of the impact site are 281.1 degrees longitude and plus 12.4 degrees latitude. Now here's a frame from one of the videos. You can see Ganymede, Io, and Europa in the frame along with the bright flash. Now the raw frames from the two videos were given to planetary imaging specialist Mark Delacroix, who processed them and found that the flash lasted a little over a second. And while the two videos seemed offset by about 9 seconds in marking the event, this appears to be real. So whatever this was, an asteroid or a comet or whatever, it was very small, and there was no debris field associated with the event, at least that we could see from these videos. Now, apparently someone asked, and the mission managers of the Hubble Space Telescope decided not to slew to Jupiter to take a closer look. At first, there was some speculation that this flash was somehow linked to Jupiter's close-in moon Amalthea, which was positioned very close to the flash when it occurred, but astronomers have ruled out that possibility. So if this evidence holds up and this turns out to be a real impact, then it will have been the fifth such event in the past decade. The largest of these occurred July 19, 2009, and it left a distinctly dark powder burn in Jupiter's upper atmosphere, first spotted by Australian astroimager Anthony Wesley. And that was followed by three lesser strikes recorded by amateur astronomers from 2010 through 2012. So see, aren't you glad we keep looking up? Told you. Finally, the Atacama Large Millimeter Submillimeter Array, also called ALMA, in Chile released observations that shows the finest detail ever seen in the planet-forming disk around the nearby sun-like star known as TW Hydra. Now, ALMA is a high-resolution radio telescope, and what you're seeing here in these images is the faint radio emission coming from millimeter-sized dust grains in the disk, revealing details on the order of the distance between the Earth and the Sun, which is about 150 million kilometers. No other radio telescope can provide this level of detail at these wavelengths. Now, what's really interesting here is that these images show a gap at the same distance from the star as the Earth is from the Sun, which may mean that an infant version of our home planet, or maybe a more massive super-Earth, is beginning to form here. Astronomers like to study TW Hydra because it's pretty close to us. It's only 175 light years away, and also it's a pretty young star. It's only about 10 million years old. It also has this really convenient face-on orientation as seen from Earth, so we can see it from above. This gives astronomers a rare, undistorted view of the complete protoplanetary disk around the star. Astronomers say that previous studies of TW Hydra with optical and radio telescopes confirm that there is a prominent disk around the star and has features that strongly suggest that planets are forming there right now. These new ALMA images show the disk in unprecedented detail, revealing a series of concentric, dusty, bright rings and dark gaps, including interesting features that may indicate that a planet with an Earth-like orbit is forming there. The other pronounced gaps that show up in the new images are located 3 billion and 6 billion kilometers from the central star, similar to the average distances from the Sun to Uranus and Pluto in our solar system. So these gaps, too, are likely to be the results of particles that came together to form planets, which then swept their orbits clear of dust and gas and shepherded the remaining materials into these well-defined bands. Well, that's it for this week, Space Fans. Thanks to all my Patreon supporters who helped make SFN better, and thanks to all of you for watching. And as always, keep looking up. Okay, so last week I talked about wanting to change the keep looking up catchphrase, and most of you responded, and I thought, you know, just an awful lot of people have been using keep looking up, so maybe we could change it. But the response I got was overwhelmingly that we should keep it. So, all right, I will keep looking up, I will keep looking up as our little tagline, even though I guess a lot of people are using it, but so what? It's a good thing to say, and you're right. We started doing it here first, I think, before a lot of these other people did. And even though Jack Horkheimer invented it, it's a good tradition to carry on. So we're keep looking up. So thanks for all your responses on that. I also want to let you guys know that starting on April 22nd, Space Fan News will not be posted on the Deep Astronomy channel anymore. It's going to be posted only on Space Fan News channel. So if you haven't subscribed to Space Fan News yet, and you still want to keep getting weekly episodes, then I would suggest you go subscribe to that channel. The description is down in the link is down in the description box below. So go ahead and subscribe to it, and that will start on April 22nd. The reason is I'm trying to segregate these because Space Fan News has its own sort of following, and I've been using Deep Astronomy to kind of get it kickstarted and get the viewership going again since we started doing this starting back in October or so. So now that we're back doing this every week, I want to post it solely on Space Fan News. So check it out there, and I will see you next week.